my church service. I need to go now.
And leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free.
Showing that it's live right now.
You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Oh, And I hope that as we are looking at the death of Jesus, as we're looking at what he did for us on that cross, that we want to follow in his footsteps to get rid of ourselves and to be more like him. That's our goal on this earth. That's what God put us here for, to worship him and to be more like him and to show the world his love. And his love is so deep that we can't even fathom.
Thanks for being our Redeemer. We look through the Old Testament, the New Testament. Everything that's there is a story of you redeeming us and Christ coming as our Redeemer. Pray we just embrace you as our Redeemer and think about what it means that someone loved us enough to redeem us. And as we think of that, that we then think how we can redeem the things around us as we just go around day to day and life, that we look and think, how do I act as a redeemer to the people around me? How do I go into a given situation and act in a redeeming way for that? I pray you just let us really deeply embrace you as our Redeemer, and then that we in turn can act as redeemers to those around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, up through fifth grade, you can all go downstairs with Miss Denise today.
It did. So I got a little bit annoyed at the beginning of the week when I started putting together this message on broken, preparing for Easter. Things started to break. My glasses broke. My car door wasn't working for a while. And just sometimes life is broken, isn't it? Like you get up in the morning and you try all of this stuff, but things are just broken. When you look at the world around us, all you have to do is look at the headlines and you see that this world is broken. We've got war breaking out. The very fact that there's children's hospitals tells us that this world is broken. We get sick. We suffer. Folks die. Homes are broken. Families are broken. Jobs are broken. And I figure if we start down here with the world being broken, by the end of today, even though we live in a broken world, I want you guys to be up here. And the difference between here and here is Jesus. Is Jesus. So we're going to make much of Jesus today. We're going to be fascinated with Jesus. We're going to read some words of Jesus, and we're going to talk about Jesus. So we are in the middle of what's known as Lent, the Lenten season, which is just a time for several weeks before Easter. It starts on Ash Wednesday. It ends on the Thursday before Good Friday during Holy Week. But it's really a time for us to be challenged to think more about Jesus. I know a lot of faith traditions have you give up stuff during Lent. And that's perfectly okay. If that helps you focus on the person and work of Christ, then by all means do it. I was always confused why if they gave up something for Lent, they just didn't give it up year round, right? But it is what it is. But it's designed to challenge people to consider the implications of Jesus's death. And over the next 4 weeks, we're going to do the same because we cannot speak of the life that we have in Christ until we consider the reasons why Christ had to come to the earth. And when we look at his death and resurrection, we're going to focus on some times when Jesus drew attention to those events in his life. And we're going to look at the necessity for Jesus's life, death, burial, and resurrection. In this first week, we're going to look at the main reason that Jesus had to come to this earth was because we needed it, was our need. And so let's look, if you have your Bibles, open it up to Matthew chapter 20. Matthew, we're going to be in two different passages. We're going to be in Matthew 20 and Mark 8. I apologize, you probably can't read it on the slide. So next week it'll be above the thing and you'll be able to read it. But Matthew chapter 20, starting in verse 26. This is a conversation that Jesus is having with his disciples about what it means to be a leader, what it means to be great. And Jesus, anytime Jesus talks, you know it's going to be entertaining. You know that it's going to cut right to the core. Because what he does is he often mentions the worldly system and then says, but that's not the way it's supposed to be for you. So anytime Jesus uses some of that terminology, we need to make sure we're considering the kingdom of God. Because you and I, we live in this world, this broken world that's ruled by a kingdom that's not our home. That's ruled by a king that is not our king. And so we need to have a kingdom mindset. We need to be agents in this secret kingdom that the kingdom should not be so secret. And so Jesus is talking about leadership here. And we're going to read a couple verses, talk briefly about it, and then we're going to zero in on verse 28. But in verse 26 of Matthew chapter 20, he says this, and this is Jesus speaking, "But among you it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave." These words servant and slave, it's kind of the lowest portion of Jewish society. And what Jesus is saying is that in God's community, it's not status, it's not money, it's not popularity that matters, but it's humility. But it's humility. And this world makes humility so hard, doesn't it? Look at what I did. you almost have to promote yourself to get raises, to get advances. When you look at social media, you are projecting the best version of yourself, right? Like another thing that broke this week, I had a fingernail break, and then I had a glass break and put a glass shard into my finger that I still can't get out, right? I don't post about that on social media because I don't want people to know I've got a bum thumb, right? But this idea of humility runs counter to what you and I are taught. But it does not run counter to the kingdom of God. And so he uses these words, if you want to be a leader, you have to be a servant. If you want to be first, you must become a slave. That idea of being a servant leader is having an attitude that in life that freely attends to others' needs without expecting or demanding anything in return. So when we help people out, we're doing so as a gift, as an act of grace, as an act of mercy, without expecting anything back. I often tell folks that I'm counseling regarding their finances, if you are dealing with friends and family, everything is a gift. You don't do loans with friends and family. It's a gift. Don't expect anything back. Because if you want to see a broken relationship, loan money to family or friends, and then wait, right? But the kingdom of God, we are servants, we are slaves, we are here to serve other people. And then Jesus offers himself as an example of true humility, as an example of servant leadership, as an example of becoming people's slaves. He says this in verse 28, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many." When we preached through, when we worked through the Gospel of Mark a few years ago, this idea of the Son of Man, we spent a lot of time talking about because it was one of Jesus' favorite descriptions of himself. He used it over 81 times in the Gospels. Very few people outside of Jesus referred to him as the Son of Man. I think there's maybe only two instances. But the Old Testament is chock full of this language, the Son of Man, the Son of Man. And when you think about it, that's kind of a strange term for Jesus, isn't it? Son of God, yeah, we're good with that. But what is this Son of Man? And Jesus was able to take that phrase and kind of fill it in with his own meaning. Because a lot of people thought the Messiah was going to be a religious, was going to be a political leader that was going to bring freedom from Rome. And when Jesus started using the Son of Man terminology, he was like, your perception of what it means to be the Messiah, of who you're looking for, is wrong. And here's what it means. And so one of the characteristics of Messiah was this: for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and give his life as a ransom for many. Now, remember, Jesus is talking to his disciples here. We don't ever want to lose sight of the audience. And so they were thinking, oh, the Son of Man came to be served, or not to be served, but to serve others. Yeah, we get that. And then Jesus says to give his life as a ransom for many. And they were like, nope, nope. This idea that Jesus would give his life, notice that it says he came to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus laid down his life voluntarily. And if anybody could demand to be served and to not have to serve other people, it was Jesus. But he's like, nope, I came not to be served, but to serve and to give, to give. And he gave his life as a ransom for many. That idea of a ransom is what's the purchase price for slaves, to be redeemed from the bondage to sin and death. And Lindsay and I really like to watch police dramas, cop shows, and things like that. And one of the things I've noticed is when somebody is being ransomed, they have no control. They have no power. They are completely hopeless, right? They're usually tied to a pole and they can't move, and duct tape and all that stuff, right? They're completely hopeless. Well, what Jesus is saying is I came as a ransom for many, which means you and I are what needs to be ransomed, which means you and I are hopeless, means you and I are tied up. That means you and I are in bondage to something that we cannot free ourselves from. So Jesus had to pay the ransom. And don't ever lose sight of little words. Ransom for. That little three-letter word for means in place of. It was a ransom in your place, in my place, in our place, and for many. So the ransom, the price that Jesus paid to deliver us, was paid for many, and it is sufficient for every single person, but it's only effective for those who believe. And so when a lot of people read this and say, oh, he gave his life as a ransom for many, he paid the price, they start to teach this idea of universalism, where everybody goes to heaven, where everybody is saved. And that's not the case. He gave his life as a ransom for many, but when you look at the whole counsel of Scripture, you have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. There's a belief component to this. But let me ask you, if you and I were not hopeless in our sin, if you and I were not hopelessly broken, would Jesus have had to come to earth? No. Our need for salvation, our need for that ransom, for that price to be paid, led to Christ coming to the earth. One of the pastors I used to sit under, his name is Dr. Mark Phillips, a different Mark Phillips. It's strange that we also know another pastor named Mark Phillips. But Dr. Mark, one time when he was preaching through Genesis, he was talking about creation, and he described what he called the divine pause. And what that was is, we know the days of creation, God created land, earth, light, all this stuff. And then right before he created, before God the Father and God the Son working together created mankind, Dr. Mark always said there was a divine pause where God the Father looked at the Son and said, are you ready? Because he knew that the minute mankind was created, mankind would enter into rebellion, would choose their own way. And the only way for that broken world to be put back together was Jesus Christ. So the Father looked at the Son and said, you know what this means. Are you ready? Because from the foundation of the world, we know that God's plan was to redeem mankind, which means that God knew in his infinite wisdom when he created mankind, he knew what we were going to do. He knew we were going to rebel. He knew that we were going to go our own way. He knew we were going to get caught up in sin and death and behavior patterns that are destructive, that are broken. And the only way that that could be healed, the only way that we could be made whole, would be through his Son, Jesus. And it floors me, because Jesus knew it too. Flip on over to Mark chapter 8. We're going to see Jesus and his disciples have another conversation. And this one gets a little bit more heated, I guess is the right word. Mark chapter 8, starting in verse 31. Then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man, there's that phrase again, must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. As he talked about this openly with his disciples, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. And Jesus turned around and looked at the disciples and then reprimanded Peter. Get away from me, Satan, he said. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. When you and I look at this broken world, we look for human solutions, don't we? We try on our own to heal ourselves. We try on our own to mend relationships. We try on our own to put things back together. I spent an hour trying to dig that little glass out of my thumb and finally gave up, right? I even anointed it with oil. That didn't work. But we try to fix things on our own. And we're in this passage, Peter tries to fix Jesus. I can't imagine. But in verse 31, it says that Jesus began to tell them. What that tells us is that there is more to the story. There's more than what Jesus said than what is recorded here in the Gospel of Mark. I think one of the scripture writers said that if they had written down everything that Jesus said and did, there would not be enough paper in the world to hold all of the books. The libraries could not be big enough just to record the works and words of Jesus, of one man. So he began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer. Now the disciples here, remember, they could not fathom a dead Messiah. They couldn't fathom Jesus having to die. This was unthinkable because the Messiah was a symbol of strength and not weakness. But Jesus began to tell them that they would suffer. But what's the word right before suffer? He must. He must. That word must, that he must suffer, means that it was a necessity. Jesus must do this. It was completely necessary for that to happen. And as we talked about, that's because in the divine order of history, mankind had gone their own way. They had rebelled against God. And as history unfolded, things got progressively worse and worse and worse and worse. And Jesus must suffer for us. And this idea of must means that our need was part of God's plan. But our need had to be met by God's love. So that must involves our need, it involves God's love, it involves that desire for God to be reconciled to us, for us to be reconciled to God, for us to be reconciled to one another. But Jesus must suffer, and then he also must be rejected. And not just rejected by the average Joe, but rejected by the elders, the leading priests and teachers of religious law. That's the Sanhedrin, that's the Sadducees, that's the Pharisees, that's all the ruling elite. They rejected Jesus. And then he would be killed. It's interesting. What is the Friday before Easter called? Good Friday. What happened on Good Friday? Jesus died. And we call it good. From the outside looking in, that's kind of strange. Hey, your Messiah, your Savior died, and you're calling it Good Friday. And we call it Good Friday because we understand the bad news of sin, the bad news of death, the bad news of rebellion. But Jesus' death was an act of obedience to the Father for his glory and for our good and according to plan from before the foundation of the world. Jesus came to die for the sins of the world, and his death is the only way that we can experience true freedom. Our key verse here at Freedom Church, if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Genuine freedom can only be found in the death of Jesus. And any time, I think almost every single time Jesus talks about his death, he talks about the resurrection. And so he says that he will be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. And he would openly talk about this. So Jesus had to help people align their expectations of what a national and political Messiah meant in reality with God's program of what the Son of Man, of what the Messiah would be. And so as he talked about this openly with his disciples, so the disciples, the 12 disciples, and probably a bunch of other people that were around hanging out with Jesus, they heard him repeatedly talk about his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And sometimes we need to have that reminder, don't we? Right? Like, they even forgot. They went back and started fishing after Jesus died, within a day. And then you and I know the reality of what happened. We've seen that reality. We live in that reality. And yet, how often do we forget about Jesus' death and about his resurrection? But as he was doing this, Peter took him aside. So Peter's like, hold on, Jesus, I think you got this wrong. And he began to reprimand him. And as I was reading this, if you take this account of what happened and you look at the context of the surrounding and you look at some of the other gospel accounts, what had happened just prior to this is Jesus had asked them the question, who do people say that I am? And they gave all these answers. Some say you're the prophet. Some say you're John the Baptist. Some say you're this. Some say you're that. And Jesus kind of brushes that aside, doesn't even care. And then he zeroes in on them and says, who do you say that I am? And what is Peter's response? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus says, you're right, Simon Bar-Jonah. Only God could reveal that to you. That happened right before this. So Jesus then would go on to say, hey, the Son of Man, he's going to suffer, he's going to be killed, and then 3 days later he's going to rise from the dead. And Peter, who had just said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, said, you get it wrong. You got it wrong, Jesus. You don't know what you're talking about. That tells me a couple of interesting things. I think Peter, he's kind of a hothead. He speaks oftentimes before he thinks, right? He's the one that thinks he has two mouths and one ear when it's the other way around. But he thinks, and this is, I believe that Peter thinks he heard from God but didn't completely understand what was going on, right? Because Jesus has just said, God had revealed this to you. Right? And so I think Peter here was too confident in his ability to hear God. He started to go against Scripture, and he started to go against the spiritual authority in his life. Jesus was Peter's pastor. And anytime I make mistakes as a pastor, it's comforting to know that Jesus, the perfect pastor, still had sheep that strayed, right? But he got too confident. And he wasn't truly listening to the word of God, to the person of Jesus, and to his spiritual authority. Warren Wiersbe said this, when we argue with God's word, we open the door for Satan's lies. And how true is that? Here, Jesus, the word made flesh, the word of God was standing and talking, and Peter said, you're wrong, and tried to rebuke him. But Jesus turned around. So Peter pulled kind of Jesus aside and rebuked him. And Jesus looked back at his disciples and then looked at Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. Why does Mark mention that he looked at his disciples? Why does he say that?
They didn't believe.
Because Jesus has a heart for people. Because Jesus wanted the disciples. And Peter's kind of viewed and portrayed as the figurehead, as the spokesman for all the disciples. So he was almost saying, Peter, I love these people. You have no idea how much I love these people. But you need to get behind me, Satan. You see, what had just happened was Jesus, and one of the reasons we celebrate Lent is Jesus spent 40 days in the wilderness being tempted by Satan. And one of the temptations that Satan did was Satan offered Jesus all the kingdoms of the world on one condition, that he would go against God's plan. And that Peter's almost repeating that same temptation here. Like, Jesus, you don't need to die, you don't need to suffer, you don't need to be rejected, right? Just, you're wrong. Let's just do this. Let's bring the kingdom now. But to do that would have required Jesus to step outside of God's plan. And that's why we talk about the upper story of God. We can get so lost in the brokenness of our everyday lower story that we lose sight of God's redemptive story. That we lose sight of God's plan, not just for us, but for his church, for his people. And over again in this world, in Scripture, and in life, we see that Satan tries to deny the value of Jesus' death. The death of Jesus is a historical fact. And people try to reframe that, try to say Jesus didn't really die, Jesus was just a person, Jesus is still dead, and none of that is true. And then he says, you, at the end of verse 33, you are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. Jesus is encouraging us to have a kingdom mindset, because without Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, we would still be in sin. You see, we live in a broken world, and you and I, prior to knowing Christ, which we're going to talk about that amazing, glorious event here in a second, prior to knowing Christ, you and I are under the penalty of sin. And without Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, we'd still be under that penalty. We would still be living and suffering on our own. We would have no victory. We would still be under the power of sin. And you and I would also, without Jesus' death and resurrection, we would have no hope for the future. Because you see, when you and I, when we believe in Jesus Christ, we are freed from the very penalty of sin, because Jesus, the Son of Man, came to give his life as a ransom for many. So when you believe that, the ransom has already been paid, you're just accepting it. That's like the prisoner, right? Who the ransom has been paid, and now they're just waiting to be set free. The handcuffs have been loosened. The door has been opened. They just have to walk through it. They're free. But as long as they stay in that room, as long as they stay under the authority of their captor, they're under the penalty of sin. When we believe in Jesus, then we get to this glorious thing called eternal life that starts the moment that we believe. And while we're still walking this earth, God continues to work on our heart. He continues to have the Spirit dwell within us and convict us of our sin. And we grow more and more and more in freedom from the very power of sin. And then when we die, we're free from the very presence of sin. Where there's no tears, no pain. Rick's going to get his leg back. So that's that kingdom mindset that you and I need to have. And we see this played out in a number of areas that when we as individuals, when we as a community, when we as a culture, when we go against God's design, we're not thinking kingdom-mindedly. When you and I, Adam and Eve, the whole reason they got in trouble, our first parents, was because they decided to go their own way. They thought that they knew better than God. And that broke the world. Yeah. But Jesus, through his suffering, death, burial, resurrection, he made all things new. And so in light of these two passages, in light of the fact that we live in a broken world, but when you and I believe in Jesus, we are in Christ, we are made whole, but we still have to walk through and navigate this broken world. My encouragement to you is, first of all, I want to invite you into that journey. I want to invite you into that journey. Most people see Lent as a time to give something up, but what if we viewed Lent, what if we viewed this time as a time to take something on? And it's what we call a double journey. It's a journey toward the mystery of God's redemptive embrace in the death and resurrection of Jesus, and it's also a journey into the depths of our humanity. But this has to happen within community. And that's why we talk about Jesus. That's why we talk about the suffering, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus. And why we do so often is because we are trying to create a community identity, a community understanding of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And you and I, we have this shared memory of who Jesus is, what Jesus was, what he did, and what Jesus is doing now. And that's why I love to hear stories of how God's working in your life, in your relationships. That's why Ted shares often about how God's working in the world. That's an invitation to a journey into God's power, into God's redemptive work, and into the depths of our humanity. And what I really want you to do this week is I want you to thank God every day, multiple times a day, for his salvation. He entered into our brokenness. He lived the life that we couldn't. He died the death that we deserve. He defeated death. He ensured our eternal life. Thank God for that. Believe in that. Live as if it were true individually and in community. And all praise be given to God. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to enter into a time of communion, the Lord's Supper. I did not ask people to pass it out. So Kent and Joe, can you help me out? The elements are in the back. We practice what we call open communion here, which means you do not need to be an official partner with Freedom Church, but we do ask that you are a follower of his, that you have believed that Jesus died for your sins, that you could not do that. We ask that you believe that to be true. We understand that we all make mistakes. We still live in a broken world. We still sin against God, but that's not who we are. We have been made new in Christ, and so if you believe that, you're allowed to partake, even if this isn't your church home. Parents, if you've had those conversations with your kids, it's up to you if you allow them to partake. And please, once you get the juice and the bread, just hold on to it. We'll take all of it together. One of my prized possessions, and I should have it here at the church, it's at home. My grandfather was a deacon in the church, and he couldn't really read a lot or read very well, and he had trouble reading the printed words, but he could read my grandmother's handwriting. He was in World War II, and they exchanged letters. And so I have my grandfather's prayer book, where my grandma wrote out his prayers. And so I have his communion prayer book, and I have his offering prayer book. And so reading through the prayers that my grandma wrote for my grandpa to read during communion, I should have brought it. But I think of that almost every time I go to talk about communion. But what we are about to do is a 2,000-year-old tradition. And Jesus instituted it when he had his disciples. One of the things I love about Jesus is he was always eating with his friends. He was always celebrating with them. And so we get to what we call the Last Supper, the Lord's Supper. And it's his last meal that he had with his disciples before he would go to the cross and die for their sins and die for our sins. And so at the end of the meal, they always had bread and they had wine. We use grape juice. But he would take the bread. I didn't get any bread, guys. I forgot to grab some. One of these days, we'll figure this out. I keep moving the communion table on them. So. Thank you, Joe. So Jesus is described as the bread of life. And if you're part of our community groups, this week we're watching the part of The Chosen where he's ministering to little kids. And one of the first things that he uses to draw them in is food, bread and stuff. And so knowing that Jesus is the bread of life, that's why I can't go gluten-free. But... bread is designed to nourish us, to strengthen us physically. And when Jesus said that he became the bread of life, or he was the bread of life, whenever we partake of communion and we eat the bread, we are remembering that Jesus is the bread of life, but we're also remembering what Jesus said that night, that his body was broken and it was given as a sacrifice. And so his broken body, his shed blood is what we remember. So as you eat this bread, I want you to remember the brokenness of Jesus' body and the brokenness that he went through for you and for me. When you look at the human body, we were beautifully made by a creator God. If you were to walk up to somebody on the street and you noticed that their arm was bleeding, that they had a bloody nose, they had blood coming out of their foot or their leg, you would know something was broken, wouldn't you? And so when Jesus said, this blood or this wine is a symbol of the new covenant, the blood that is shed for you, in order for blood to be shed, Jesus' body had to be broken. Jesus' heart had to be pierced. And so when you and I drink this, we remember the shed blood of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, for your sin and for mine. We're going to sing one of my favorite worship songs. It's top five easily. But Kelly's going to lead us in the song Jesus Messiah. And if you're not familiar with the song, we've sung it a lot here at Freedom Church, so you should be familiar with it. But if you're not, I want you to just meditate on the words of what it means for Jesus to be our Messiah, for Jesus to enter into our brokenness and make us whole. for Jesus to enter into the brokenness of the world and make a way for the world to be redeemed and put back together. And my hope and prayers over the next 4 weeks as we look at this some more, it really prepares our hearts for Palm Sunday and really prepares our hearts for what we celebrate on Resurrection Sunday. Because what is broken is made new through Christ. Amen?
Amen. Amen. And stand with us if you would like, or you can sit and reflect, whatever you are comfortable doing.
Sin, who knew no sin.
All right. Thank you all for being here today. We're going to close with a benediction. So if you're new or you haven't been here in a while, we stand up and we speak this. You can talk to somebody. You can just speak it to yourself. But we say this together. And this is only our second week, so we haven't quite got the cadence yet. But I love you all, and so we'll get it, all right? So remember, we pause when there's commas, right? And we pause at the end of the line. Okay, let's go. Father, help us to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Spirit, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Amen. Have a good week, guys.
Love you, Pastor Scott.
Love you too, buddy.
I think I'm going to end the live now.